how to build an eight-figure company, even if you weren't the smart kid in your school, tall enough, look good enough, old enough, etc., whatever you think is the determining factor why you can't, this episode's going to show you why you can. And in today's episode, we're going to go over things like, what are the four different ways you can give as a Christian? What are the ways that you can lean on God for your expertise where you don't need to be the smart one, but know the smart one that is, and how you can build a business based on your faith being first? Welcome to God's Business, a show where I interview the top entrepreneurs, thought leaders, and influencers that are all Christians, where you can build not just a good business, but God's business, where He is the multiplier of your success. And today's episode, I get to bring in a great friend of mine that's actually the co-founder of KeyGlee, one of the world's largest real estate wholesalers with over 100 locations in the U.S. I want to make for sure that I got 100 locations correct, which is just insane. And then he also is the founder of New Reach Education, an online education platform that publishes well-known brands such as Astro Flipping, Sub 2, and Credit Stacking, literally taking people's hard-earned knowledge bases and actually putting the marketing platform around it to create a business and get that message out into this world. This guy's a phenomenal entrepreneur. Welcome my friend Josiah Grimes. Josiah, what's up, man? Welcome to God's Business Podcast.
Dude, pumped to be here, bro. Literally pumped to be here. And like, this is like my two favorite things ever combined into one. So wicked excited, pumped.
Yeah. And when my first impression of you, when I met, we met through a mastermind, and the mastermind's called Wellspring. Phenomenal. Pete Vargas. We got to meet. I didn't know about all your business credentials, which I want to get into because I believe it just brings validity to who you are and what you're going to talk about. We judge a tree by its fruit. And I truly believe that your fruit's been amazing and people have talked so highly of you, and I've been able to see you and meet you and kind of watch you from a distance, you know, even in your office. Sometimes I cruise by and look through the windows and just make sure. Oh, he's in there. Yeah, he does work. That's just crazy. These credentials are real. But on the faith side as well, I saw that was really big. For you, like, I think it's interesting. Tell me your background with the faith journey. I don't really know it, but obviously it's very, very strong for you. We hit it off on a lot of those things, like the kingdom of God is not a matter of talk, but of power. And you've experienced some of that. What was the journey of experiencing that? Was it always that way? Did you grow up that way? Was this something you found?
Good question, man. I mean, so in some ways, my story is like, it's not that crazy. It's like, I wasn't like a drug addict or anything. You know what I mean? That would have been epic in a lot of ways and terrible in others. But I grew up in a Christian household. You know, parents were believers, brought us up in the church, which was awesome. I was always super zealous for my faith. So like, I could argue with anyone. You know what I mean? Like, I could tell you why Christianity is right, and whatever it is that you believe that's not Christianity is wrong for all of these different reasons, right? And so I got in plenty of arguments and debates because of that. And probably, I don't know, somewhere in my teens, later teens, right, I kind of had this realization of like, dude, you know, like, I better make sure that I'm squared away here. You know, like, I better make sure that this is actually right.
I'm good at arguing, but like, am I actually right in this whole thing?
Yeah, am I actually right? Oh crap! You know what I mean? So, and that was kind of a whole new journey, like at that start. You know what I mean? And so, kind of some maybe pivotal moments there would be like, I started to pray in the morning. Like two actually pivotal moments. One was, growing up, we were pretty late to church most of the time. Okay, honestly, right? We went to this big church, so we'd show up late, we'd miss worship or whatever, and that was just kind of standard. So one thing I did is I volunteered at church, and so when I volunteered at church in the youth, I went to like four worship, you know, sessions a weekend, and then you don't, you know, like if you're volunteering in church, you're supposed to be like the chaperone. You know what I mean? So like, you don't want to be the chaperone that's not like praising God and you know, like being a good example. And so I was like, all right, well, I'm going to get really into this. Right. And so maybe the first thing was like feeling the Holy Spirit's presence in worship. Right. And then the realization that when you're worshiping, you're actually singing to God, right? That's, you're talking to God, you're interacting with God, you are praising God. And that's a real thing. Not like you can, not like fake, but you're actually like, God, this is for you. Right. And that was a big shift. And when I did that, I started to actually feel the Holy Spirit, right, which is like a warmth or like an energy in a way, right? And felt amazing. You know what I mean? It felt incredible. And so I started to experience that there. And that's when I was like, huh, you know, maybe there's something a little bit here. And other things, you know, so that was one pivotal point. Another point was starting to pray in the morning. So like 10 minutes in the morning, 10 minutes at night, by myself in my room on my knees and praying out loud. I think praying out loud is a game changer, was a game changer for me. But praying out loud, and I kind of like worked through the Lord's Prayer, essentially, right? And then I kind of embellished or talked more on it and added a little bit more like thank you type stuff on the front end of it. And doing that, just like by myself praying, right? It says like, you know, get alone with God, right? And go into your secret place and pray to Him. And that's where I felt like I really started to develop relationship, right? Where like the Holy Spirit would come up and I would be like, what is this, right? And like start to actually have that type of encounter. And where it's like a physical manifestation of God's presence. And that's freaking cool. You know what I mean? Like, then you're like, dang, this is legit. So that's, so that was part of it. Maybe the next step was, somebody turned me on to Todd White. This is a while back when, you know, a lot of people didn't know who Todd White is. Some people listening to this probably still don't. You should check him out. But, and someone was like, dude, have you seen this guy? He's like walking around on the street praying for people and people are getting healed. And he's like getting words of knowledge and telling them stuff. And I watched it and I was like really hopeful that it was real. But at the same time, I was like, that's fake. I was like, no way, dude, like that's fake. But at the same time, I was also like, you know what? I want to see the miracles. Like, I want to see the stuff that is in the Bible. Like, I want to experience that. Right. You know, like I had a really strong desire and still do to experience and see those things. Right. And God says, if you seek, you find. Right. He says he's standing there knocking. If you open the door, he'll come in and dine with you. And so, and he rewards those who seek him. And so I was like, all right, well, let's get after this. And so I was like, okay, well, I'm going to get around those people and I'm going to dive into this. And so I started, I read a lot of books, right? Generally business books, you know, and a lot of them are on Audible. And so I started like, I'd read a business book and then I'd read like a Christian book and I'd read a business book and Christian book and business book, Christian book. And that was one way maybe I was seeking, and you know, the prayer in the morning and at night, which sounds super religious, but honestly, I was able to connect with God that way and spend time listening for him. And then all of a sudden, dude, like stuff just started opening up. Like there's a pivotal moment. I was at church and literally, dude, in the men's bathroom. Okay. I was in the men's bathroom and I'm walking over like wash my hands or whatever. And this guy looks at me, he's this older gent, my church. And he's like, he just pauses awkwardly. You know, like when someone's going to give you like a prophetic word, there's like this awkward pause. Okay. And he's like, you're a prophet. And I was like, I don't know, bro. Like, and he's like, you, God gives you words for other people. And I was like, you know, like, okay, yeah, maybe whatever. And he's like, and then he just like prayed that God's going to open up more of that. Right. And I was like, well, that's awesome. Like, sounds good to me. Like, amen. Right. Like, that sounds awesome. So then I walk out of the bathroom, I go sit in the sanctuary and I'm sitting there and I'm just like praying, thanking God for it. And this little lady walks by and, you know, she's just like little lady walking up that the little pew aisle or whatever. And, just like stops and looks over at me. And, she's like, oh, you know, like kind of like, you know, comes over to me and she's like, God's going to give you words for people, and like repeats the word, just like, boom, 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 dude. I was like, Holy Spirit just hit me. I start bawling, bro. Like like when I feel like sometimes, like when God gives you a word, he confirms it with his spirit a lot of times, right? Which is you feel it manifest. He manifests on you. And like, that's where you feel his love. And you're just like, freaking boom, punched in the face. You know what I mean? And so anyhow, dude, so that happened. From that point, bro, like all types of cool stuff started happening, dude. I started like legit understanding God's voice and getting words for people, right? Where you, and like, it's when you get a word from God, God gives you a word and you share it with someone and they start bawling. You know what I mean? And it's like exactly speaks to their situation. You're like, wow, dude, God was on that. And you realize like you, for me, it's kind of like, I like to come up with a word myself, which is not how I get correct words. Like I like to make crap up. Like I was probably thinking this, but disciplining yourself to like, no, I'm going to Jesus for this word. I'm going to God. I'm going to the Holy Spirit for this word, and resting. And if he doesn't give you a word, there's no word. Right. And then when he does give you a word, having the obedience to step out, something I'm still working on, you know, to be diligent in, bro. God would be like, work needs to happen there. But, starting to get those words where like, dude, God put that in my mind, and where they're like insane, dude. Like I got this one, it was like, anyhow, I won't go into all of it, but like I got one that was like a dragonfly and I tied in so perfectly to this dude's situation. It was the weirdest thing ever. So yeah, like there's just, God's so cool. And then, stuff, praying for people, people getting healed, a lot of really amazing things started to kind of happen after that and manifest after that. And then, so anyhow, dude, that's a little bit in
long story. You know, it's like, for me, I didn't get saved till I was 18. I come from like more of the demonic side. Then I became a Christian. I was very expectant in what God was going to do, but I didn't have any type of like, I need to find this for myself. Mm-hmm. You had this, like, I go to church, we go, I'm zealous, but you like intellectually knew, but there's like different phases, right? Like, I love when people talk about like knowing God as a father, knowing him as a friend. Obviously we go into like provider and protector, but like father, friend and co-laborer, like I look at him as a business partner, like, hey, I'm here to work with you. And there's phases where we need to like dive back into all of those. Like, there's times where I'm building my business and I'm like, God, I don't know if I really know you as a friend. Like, this was my last season. I'm like, I don't know if I really talked to you that way in a long time. Like, I've just been like mission, like, let's get it done, let's do this. But I have never really, I hadn't been enjoying. I wasn't as childlike. There was a lot of things missing there. And so I think it's interesting for you to go through that journey of having your own experience. And I think that's something that we all, it's like, that's something that daily should be done. Mm-hmm. It's like, even if you've been doing your own experience, I would be like, yeah, you need to receive that as well. Cause like, it's time to go out there and seek the new thing. Like, you're still alive. That, like, if we've only seen with a telescope part of the universe that God's spoken to existence that continually is being created around us. And we're like, just now we're like, yeah, I think Pluto's ice. Like, we should probably not call that a planet. And like, that's how far we are in it. It's like, imagine how getting to know God is, right? Like, seeing someone is not that difficult. Seeing a planet or a galaxy is not that hard. Getting to know a person is very difficult. So I'm just like, whoa, this should be something we do. So I really appreciate that. Appreciate you sharing the framework on how you do it as well. How did you get introduced? Because part of that was before business. Part of it, you were saying business book, spiritual book, business book, spiritual book. When did you feel like you were called into business specifically?
Dude, so I felt like, honestly, man, God put it really cool. I feel like my mom always encouraged me in business, and he really just placed it on me, dude, when I was young. So like probably like six, like at first, like when I was five, six and seven, I think I wanted to be like an inventor. And I think I first got called an entrepreneur in second grade. Right. So like it was just kind of like something that my mom encouraged in me. I naturally was super driven towards, dude. Like, I have notes from being a little kid trying to work out a business and like how much money I could make if I did, you know, if I did these different things. And so I was just kind of, God just sort of placed on me as I was always oriented that way. Yeah, dude. So it was kind of always something I always wanted to pursue. Yeah, my mom.
This would be like in the sales conversation, right? I'd be like, how long have you been wanting to do that? And they'd be like, forever. And I'd be like, how long have you been actually trying to do it? Right. Totally different phase. So in the not sales conversation, but getting to know you side, you knew it. Yeah. I'm going to be an entrepreneur. I've always kind of been that way. When was your real entering in where you're like, you know, like I started a lawn mowing business when I was 12, but we technically just took cash and I didn't really file it as business. Yep. And then it was like when I was 20 and I got married that I was like, all right, I entered into this world because like there's an EIN number. There's like real stuff moving. When was your real entry, you feel like, in entrepreneurship?
Yeah, totally. Because like, I mean,
more business, I guess.
Yeah, because I did the snack shops, bro. I freaking tried to hire this one guy for lawnmower. I tried to hire my neighbor. I think I was like 10, 9 or 10. And I like quickly typed up on Word doc like a employee contract, and I gave it to him. He was like 16 or something. He's like, did you just type this up on the computer? I was like, no.
Yeah, bro. But I printed out flyers on my computer and I used clip art because like this was like, you know,
let's go.
2002, and I was like, I got clip art lawnmower, and there was like a guy, and mine was so bad, bro, I wasn't saved, right? So I called it Nick's Lawn Care. We mow it and blow it.
Wow, very nice, very nice.
I was like, because like I didn't, I was like, man, this would be so funny, man. Like, let's go make money, but like, look at this joke.
Oh my gosh.
And like, it was terrible, bro. I was like, oh my gosh. All right, so yours is better. You had an employee contract. I didn't go that far. I just was like, let's go door to door, and we'll find the. We only knocked on the doors of people that obviously had the worst yards ever. Like their grass is like this big. I was like, hey, are you in the need for this service?
Oh my gosh.
yeah, it's like so funny, bro. So keep going. You started that way. That's awesome, dude. Simple stuff.
Yeah, dude, simple stuff, snack shops. I sold snacks out of my locker at school until the principal said I couldn't do that anymore. He was nice about it though, so I was good. But lots of things like that. And then I got an internship, a guy named Cody Sperber, secular business guy. And that was
I know Cody. I didn't know. When was that? That must have been a long time ago.
Yeah, I started with him when I was 17. So God opened a door in real estate. I didn't want to be in real estate, bro. Like, I wanted to make money online.
And at the time, wholesaling, this was still the thing, wholesaling for him or single family?
Yeah, it was wholesaling, dude. And, but yeah, man, like, I didn't want to be in real estate because I was straight up just afraid to make phone calls. Like, I wanted to make money online because then I could just, like, had this imaginary dream or whatever where I'm just sitting at my computer making money and I don't have to talk to any of the people. It just happens. You know, I just magically make money. And God was like, no, bro. I'm going to open the door in real estate where you have to go shake hands and make connections. So, but yeah, dude. So I started a business. Originally, the plan wasn't to be an intern. It was to learn from him and then do the business. And so that would have been, I was 17 or something like that. And that was my first official, actually, shoot, before that, I started like two other goofy little businesses where I had like an EIN number, a bank account. But that one was probably the most official. And then I ended up being partners with Cody in his investment business and then branched off on my own. And I was probably 21 or something like that when I branched, 22 maybe, 21, 22 when I branched off on my own. And so that was kind of the big change. And then partnered with Hunter Rahima and Jamil for KeyGlee and then partnered with Nick Fisher for New Reach. And it's been a blast, dude. It's been good.
So while we're there, then just break down what you do now, how you guys are doing, like your companies are doing well. It seems like
yeah.
What you guys do is kind of all over the place as well, though. Like, meaning you have real estate, you know real estate, but then you guys have this education stuff and all this stuff. Break down what the companies do and how they're doing as well.
Yeah, dude. I mean, God's the bomb, bro. He's blessed us tremendously, and if I get a chance, I want to drop a few things that were really beneficial to me. You know, from a Christian business person's standpoint, or something that a Christian business guy at one point sewed into me, like principles that I then followed that I feel like have drastically benefited my life. But KeyGlee right now, we've got about 120 franchisees or franchise units around the U.S., like about 6 corporate stores. In our corporate stores, we'd probably do 40, 50, 60 deals, something like that a month. All wholesale, right? And then franchises above that, but I don't know that number off the top of my head. So that's going well, continuing to grow. It's a lot of fun. We have a blast. Like, wholesaling is such a cool business. And so what we really did is try to make it so it was more streamlined, make the margins better and take out the initial upfront investment that a lot of people have to make in marketing. And so that kind of created a new strategy. We spent a few hundred, we may have broached, 7 figures now in tech spend for building out like our lead generation process and things like that allow us to do the business faster. And so that's been super fun. It's continuing to grow. Lots of good stuff there. And then, so that's KeyGlee. And then on the New Reach side, New Reach is kind of like the umbrella company for a lot of educational brands, right, that teach people. The biggest thing is we want to unlock financial freedom for our members through education, right? And it's practical and actionable education, right? Like, there's a place, if you want to be a doctor, go to a traditional school, which is awesome. But one of the things, like when I was in high school, I mean, I went to a school that, you know, was like Socratic method, which is amazing. That's super cool. But it was like, you know, arts and history and, you know, it was a liberal arts school, right? Which is cool, but no one really knows how to make money, you know, or run a business, that type of stuff. And so I was always thirsting for that type of information, right? Like when I read Rich Dad, Poor Dad, and he's like, you need to become financially literate. I was like, that's awesome. How do I do that? Where's the book that says financial literacy 101? Here you go. You know what I mean? And so, and then from there, what does that graduate into, right? And how can I really start a successful business and run it well? And what's a model I can follow? And so that's kind of what New Reach is about, is it's providing that education and unlocking financial freedom for members. And so we've got some really cool, we do that through education and communities. And so we've got some really cool communities and education. So like Sub2, Astro Flipping, or Credit Stacking are 3 of our brands, or Royalty Hero, and they all educate in different niches. And kind of the thing there is like, and this is interesting, right? Because it can be like, for instance, if you go get your, I noticed this when I got my finance degree, right? Because I was not the smartest person in that class. Like I was like, I don't know where I technically sit grade wise, but like looking around, I was probably average, maybe worse. You know what I mean? Like I remember this one dude, bro. And like he was in my class and I would get tutoring from him. You know what I mean? Like we're supposed to be the same level, but he's so much smarter. I just like sit there. I'm like, bro, please help me. And so, and that was to get a finance degree. Right. And he went on and got an offer from a really legit, you know, finance company. Right. And wholesaling, I made like three or four times that year while I was in school. I made like three or four times what he made off that offer. And what I was like thinking in my brain is like, dude, one, I'm not that smart. Two, all right, what I've just realized is that there are ways that you can earn money that are easier than your conventional paths, right? And so when you find those opportunity areas, which is what we do at New Reach, is we want to find those opportunity areas and then take them to the masses, right? So that a lot of people can benefit from them, you know what I mean? And that can be their first company, it can be their 17th company, right? But finding those gems, finding those areas where you can earn, like if you want to be good at anything, like you want to be a good janitor, dude, it's going to take you 3 months. You know, like you have to put in an investment to know what type of chemical goes where. Otherwise, you know, you can, I don't know, like bleach something incorrectly or something. So
yeah.
So now, dude, that's kind
and,
of.
And one good like quote that I love for that is, what costs more, ignorance or education? Because even for the janitor one, it's like there's plenty of janitors that just try to go, oh, I'm going to go use this cleaner and I'll just go out there and I'll just start doing the service.
Yep.
And whether it's on the business side or even the service side, if you don't get educated, then the ignorance costs you more than the education will ever cost.
Yeah, totally.
Because you're going to make a mistake. You're not going to have as good of a product. Or on the other side, even if you have a great product and you know how to clean, you don't know how to run a company. You don't know how to market. Mm-hmm. You don't know how to cover your butt. Like you don't know how to, you don't know what insurance to get. And so it's like each step of it. I was just talking with Brandon because Brandon, a mutual friend of ours, Brandon Poulin, he has this phenomenal strategy days that he does with people. And one of the people I'm talking to them, and you know, it's not like inexpensive in people's eyes, like that's all subjective, which I can talk about that for like 30 minutes, but it's like, you know, it's 25 grand and you meet with Brandon. And so I'm literally talking to them and I'm like, did you know that one bad hire that you have to replace on average is 30 grand statistically? Some maybe more, maybe less, but I'm like, literally, if you're just suck at that one thing one time and you don't have someone come in, I'm like, what costs more, ignorance or education? And it's like, mm-hmm. It's so simple, right? It's like, yeah, if the whole world did that, they do it with college because that's a social norm.
Yep.
Like they're like, oh, this, it's widely accepted by everyone. So because of that, I'm willing to take a fat risk on not so good loan to go here and hopefully it'll give me something. Whereas like self-education is a little bit newer. And so because of that, like they don't get the praise of everyone else. And I just think that's awesome what you're doing. I want you to tell me the wisdom thing. So, and not end this because we still have some time. I got you sitting here. I'm going to suck everything out of your brain. There's a few things. I think you're very smart. Yet Rick Pino was just at one of my events and he said something really profound. And he said when in Deuteronomy 8:18, when it says, remember the Lord your God, for it is he who gives you the ability to produce wealth. He said, why does it say, remember the Lord your God? And he said, it's because when God gives you a gift, you can use it without him. It's like, he's like,
That's good.
Remember the Lord your God. Cause like, let's say a physical gift, right? Like not just a spiritual gift. You start praying in tongues and you start praying in a different language. That may not happen if you're not, if God doesn't do it. Right.
Yep.
But a physical gift, like when Solomon needed the temple built, he got a bronze worker.
Yep.
Like he's like, who's the best bronze worker? They found him and you put him in. That guy could work on bronze whether he knew about God or not because he had built a skill. But like, where did it come from? Where did the skill come from? And is he recognizing that? So for you, it sounds like you were born with this like kind of entrepreneurial business kind of mind. People say that's a good thing. On the opposite side, it's a hard thing because you could easily use that without him. Right? So like for you, how do you mesh those two together? Because I think it'll be unique for you. For me, I like how to beg God for everything. I was like, God, like, I don't know how to build this business. Like, what am I going to do? You know, so it was like full, like, feeling of reliance. But still, like, I saw my own journey with it.
Yep.
For you, you could have easily been like, man, I'm good at this. Like, I'm going to do it, and then I'll give him glory. Good job, God. Like, even though I didn't incorporate you into any part of this process, how do you incorporate God into business together? And how do you like hear his voice for direction? Do you hear his voice, or do you just use scripture? Maybe there's a format for that. And then don't leave out that wisdom from that mentor either. I want to hear this.
Yeah, dude. It's a great question, man. Honestly, my viewpoint of it though is that I would not be nearly as successful without God. Right. So that's my hard and fast, legit. Like I couldn't read until like sixth grade. You know what I mean? So like I was not, I mean, maybe some areas God gave me.
Maybe your mom was just like, you're got a business mind. And it was actually like,
everything else.
You ain't going to get a job. I'll tell you that. So, you know,
dude,
it's like the guys that I have, it's like guys that I have in the community that are felons and they come out of jail or something like that. And they're like, yeah, it was awesome. They built this business. And I'm like, yeah, like they had a choice. Where are they going to get a job? I'm like, where are you going to get a job, bro? Like, no wonder you did that. You know, so yeah, it's like we have to. So anyway, keep going.
Straight up though, dude. But honestly, man, like, everything I have, I see it as stemming from God. And it's really interesting, right? Because it talks about not seeing like a fool as wise in his own eyes, right?
Yep.
And, but then it also talks about, I think it's in Romans, right? You shouldn't think more of yourself than you ought, right? So you should also have an understanding of where God has gifted you. But in all reality, dude, like I know for a fact that if I decided I was going to depart from God, that none of this happens, bro. Like, I feel like God has placed a special super, this might sound weird, but like a supernatural blessing on my work and the things that I do, and literally gives me phenomenal ideas, bro. And I like, it doesn't happen without him, honestly, man. Like it really freaking doesn't. So I could act all prideful, like, yeah, bro, I got this figured out, but that's bull crap, dude. Like I literally, my stuff falls apart without God, period. Right. So I think, yeah, dude. So I honestly don't feel that way. I don't feel like, oh, Grimes, you're actually really, really good at this. And even if God didn't have a hand in it, you could still thrive. Nah, bro.
Yeah.
Like there's so many times, dude, where God's hand's been on the business or been on the decision, or where I've been like, God, I have no clue what to do. And he's been like, here's a solution for you. Right. Or where I can trust in him. Right. And that's another thing, is it says, acknowledge him in all your ways and he'll make your path straight. So acknowledge him in all your ways. Like, don't forget that. Okay. Like when something's going well, you give him a shout out because he's the reason why it's going well. Right. And if you want to miss those shout outs, cool. But then you're rolling the dice. And so I think that, yeah, dude, I don't think my stuff works without God, period. And, I think,
isn't that interesting though? Cause like where else is there a show like this where we can really peel back the three-dimensional world and look like, for lack of better words, like the four-dimensional world, like the spiritual realm and who you are inside of spirit, and be like, man, this is how you're making decisions. Cause a lot of times, again, you learn a framework, right? If I were to pray, ask God, get direction and I lost 60 pounds. I can now framework that out in the natural where people can follow that. Yep. But like my internal transformation may have been like an encounter with God, understanding what I was built for, that my body's a temple, that I'm meant to do everything with excellence because that's the identity of who I am. I'm a citizen of heaven, not a citizen of earth. I'm not a part of this culture. Like I could be influenced by the culture. I could be influenced by the culture of heaven. We have to figure out what culture we're a part of and make a decision on what that is. Like, I feel that there's not enough of this going on, this conversation. And part of it's the callings, right? It's my calling. And this is why I'm going to dominate this space, is because it's like, I feel like it's time to showcase some of that. Cause you're like, man, my, this is how it all happens. And I'm like, man, if we can show that to people, people want, like, desire that, right? Like that, they're like, I want to get to know this God. Like, who is the God that, and we see this throughout scripture. Who's God? Mm-hmm. Even Deuteronomy 18, the wealth was given to them just so that they could see that the covenant was established with them and that God was with them and people would see it. And God used wealth to show that, which is crazy. Yep. Not always, but he did.
Mm-hmm.
And you're talking about the same exact thing. What? I want to hear from your mentor. What were these key wisdom principles from your mentor?
Yeah, dude. So there's actually, it's two. And it was from two different people, right? One was literally in, children, what's it called? Sunday school. There we go. One was literally in Sunday school and they told the story of Solomon. Right. And I knew at this point that I wanted dollars. Right. Like I thought like that sounded like a great gig. And they told the story where Solomon instead asks for wisdom to rule justly and righteously. Right. And then God gives everything else because he asked for that. Right. And obviously in James, it says if we ask for wisdom, he's going to give it to us. And dude, that's like, we need wisdom as business owners. If you want to grow a sound business, a business that produces peace, you need God's wisdom. And so you have to keep that, right? And so one, you need to spend a ton of time in the word. You need to know Proverbs forward, backwards as much as you possibly can, right? And then you got to ask God for wisdom, right? Like that hit me hard. And doing that, God has supplied the wisdom that I've needed along the way, right? And he's faithful to supply it, man. Sometimes I'm, you know, like it's a joy, right? And we as Christians get a walk in that, as sons and daughters, we get a walk in that. And he says he'll give it to us. So let's ask for it, right? So that's one. Because I think that you can produce an organization like none other with a peace that permeates it like none other when you're acting in wisdom and God will give it to you. You just got to ask, right? So that's one, ask. Ask and you will receive, right? That your joy may be made full, right? Ask in Christ's name. And so that's one. Two, and this is about giving, because we're business peeps, right? So we're big on money. And what I do not get, actually, I totally get it, but what I am very passionate about, okay, is we're big on money, right? Okay, God's placed it in our hearts to go and get money and then use it for good, right? And a lot of people, they'll go to God and they'll say, God, like, man, I can't make the payments for this on Friday and I need money, right? And when we ask God for money, when do we want it? We want it like right now. You know, like God, now would be great. Just like in this instant. Okay.
Yeah. If we're asking, it's already too late. You know, it's like,
yeah,
it's
dude. Like, well, there's not always. I mean, like make your request known to God. Right. And then, his peaceful that surpasses all understanding will guard your hearts and minds. And so there's always provision from God and he says it to ask. So ask if you're in need. And he'll give, right? And sometimes it's going to be the last minute, but have confidence in him. And that way you won't go on a roller coaster ride. You'll be solid. Like, for instance, this is a little bit of a tangent from what I actually want to talk about. But for instance, David, right? So King David, their families and all their belongings are stolen as the men are away. I can't remember who they're fighting or whatever. They come back and their wives, their children, and their belongings are gone. Okay? Like, adios. All right. Now, most people are freaking losing their minds, right? Like going bananas. What does David do? David doesn't go on this roller coaster of shenanigans. David walks away from everyone, gets on his knees and says, God, help me. Right. And then what happens? They went and they recovered everything and more. Not a single person missing. OK, well, that David saw God's plan. And so his path was even. He didn't have to have an emotional roller coaster. He didn't have to lose his shenanigans. And that's why he's a leader. Right? Because he trusted in God throughout. Whereas anyone else would have been losing their minds. Right? And so, all right. So anyhow, so trust in God. He'll provide the way. We are rooted in Christ. That's why ours is smooth when other people are going up and down, even though they can look at us and say like, aren't things going crazy? We're like, no, dude, I serve a good God. Like he's got the plan for me. Right? And so we can rest in that. And that happens. You get the people back, right? God provides. He always does. He's faithful. Right. So there's that. Okay. With that, a lot of people ask for money and they want it now. Okay. When we are business people, we are money oriented. Right. And God entrusts us with money. So like, if you look at the talent, like the parable of the minas or the talents, right. God will jump your capacity drastically. Right. Like, hey, here's 5 mina. I mean, I'm gonna mess the numbers up. Okay. Bear with me, but here's 5 mina. Take care of these mina. All right. Sweet. Thanks for the 5 or the 10 or whatever it is. I take those 5, comes back, and here's 10, right? And the master says, here's 10 cities. All right, mina, I think it was like, I remember doing the math at some point. It was like $50. Like it was, you know, like it's probably an anachronism or something like that. Might've been a little bit more, maybe like $500. But it was like nothing. Like it was not very much money. It went from like $500. He turned that into $1,000 and God gave him 10 cities, right? That's a big freaking jump. You're like, whoa, right? But God had to know that he was faithful with little. If you are faithful with little, then you'll be faithful with much, right? Mm. And so there's 4 types of giving in the Bible, right? There's tithe, and there's a promise which with each one of them, right? Wow. And so know these, own these, enjoy these, right? Because they actually physically separate your heart from the desire after wealth, right? And God needs that to trust you so that he can give you more.
I got my notes out. Bring it.
That's awesome. So the four, tithe, right? For the tithe, that's 10% of what you make, right? I would say don't do that after tax. Do that pre-tax, right? Before you pay tax, right? If you want more blessing, do it before tax, right? Pre-tax, 10%. Let's go. God's a giver, dude. You can't outgive God, right? Yeah. 10%. Okay. Like just give as much as you possibly can, especially when you're starting. And just continue that forever, right? But tithe, the promise there is he'll rebuke the devourer on your behalf. The guy that I learned that from talked about how he had AC units that were 40 years old on his rentals, and they never went out and they pumped out perfectly cool air, right? Whereas everyone else by that point had to flip out their ACs sometimes twice. His were cruising, right? But what you'll see is you'll see a lot of entrepreneurs don't tithe, and they build up this big business and then they lose it, right? Because God's promise is he'll rebuke the devourer on your behalf for the tithe. It's a promise. So tithe, and he rebukes the devourer, the person that comes to steal, kill, and destroy your business, right? And destroy your stuff. So that's tithe. Two, first fruits, right? Give your first fruits. You're dedicating that portion to him. So that looks like you have a new business venture. Your first sale, 100% of that goes to God, right? It looks like if you get a raise at work, the difference in that raise, 100% of that goes to God, right? First paycheck, that difference goes to God, right? Like give your first fruits. Most of us aren't growing like fruits and vegetables, right? So like it's a little bit different than it used to be. Okay. We don't have vineyards and no one, you know, like most of us aren't farmers. So then give that first.
I'm growing an apple tree and just so that I can, I'm like going to hit it to a T, bro.
Let's go, bro.
First fruits. Here we go. Okay. Keep going. We got first fruits, dedicate them to him. It could be a first sale. Goes to God, yep. Or maybe you get a distribution, you get something.
Your first distribution. And giving a piece. Yeah, dude. And you give all of that first distribution, you give the full thing, right? And so it's first fruits. You're dedicating that new venture to God, right? And he'll bless you for it. The next is offering. That's over and above that 10% that you gave on tithe, right? Anything over and above that is offering, you bless that 30, 60, and 100 fold, right? So if you want to grow, give an offering on top of your tithe, right? That's that additional amount. This needs to go towards God's work. Some people say it needs to be brought into the storehouse, which is the local church. Maybe that's the case. Give it to your local church. Give it to something that's preaching the gospel, right? Give it to something that's doing good works, God's works, right? With God attached. Yep. That's hugely important. Another thing that blew me away is God cares so much about us for eternity, because his perspective is on eternity. So if he's choosing to heal someone's broken leg, which is causing them pain right now, or get someone into heaven, and having them meet Jesus, the person, it's like not even a comparison. Having them meet Jesus is way up here, the broken legs down here. He cares about both, right? Yep. But the salvation is super important. So anyhow, I like to make sure that there's some gospel portion when I'm giving, that there's some, that it's preaching the gospel somehow, right? That could be through providing food and other stuff, but it's preaching the gospel somehow. All right. And then lastly is alms, right? And alms is giving to the poor. And what God says about alms is it's like borrowing from God, right? So you're getting it back. Right. And it says, dude, I was literally reading in Proverbs today, right? Like I'm gonna see if I can pull this up.
The butcher of the scripture is when you give to the poor, you lend to the Lord.
Exactly, dude. Yeah, that's bang on, dude. And then there's also the bit where it's like, oh, I don't know if I'm gonna be able, whoever oppresses the poor will increase his own wealth or gives to the rich. That's not what I was looking for. I was looking for whoever closes his ear to the cry of the poor will himself call out and not be answered, right? So like give alms. You're lending to God. You're getting it back, right? But give alms. So alms, first fruits, tithe, and offering are the four ways that are depicted in the Bible, right? They all come with a promise. And we are in this realm, right? We're in the realm of wealth. God will grow you so very, very quickly. But you need to be faithful in those things. And when you're actually doing them, it's physically, some people feel like, why do I actually need to do that? Is it really going to actually do anything? And it will physically separate your heart from the love of money, right? Because the exercise is what builds the muscle. And so you need that so that you can, one, be faithful, but two, so God can trust you with much. So now that's pray for wisdom. Go after those four ways of giving. And then my last bit there is we always want God to give to us like instantly. So don't be late. Like you get paid, first thing you do is a tithe, right? Like I don't, like there's boxes in the back of my church. I don't put the money in those boxes. I send it online so that I can send it the same day, right? It's the first thing I'm doing. I'm sending it. And then, you know, try to figure it out so you don't have to pay a bunch of fees, like the 3%, whatever shenanigans if you pay online. But get that money out instantly, right? You want, like, God's gracious. He gets it. He's awesome. He's good. But let's be extraordinarily faithful and timely. We want God to be timely when we need something. So let's be make sure that we are bang on timely when it comes to money and it comes to God. So that's my, I could go on a bunch of other tangents, but those are pray for wisdom, give those four ways, give on time.
So good, dude. And even going back to, you talked about like, as an entrepreneur, we're wanting to make money. And really like, even when you look at money, I always talk about from my mentor, Cole Hatter, he talked about that basically it's like the oxygen of a business. So like I always looked at like you give to missionaries because producing money as a missionary isn't a sign of like health of a missionary is like how much they can go sell services. They're taking money and they're going and do something really good. Whereas with a business owner, you give them money and a lot of times it weakens that part of them, almost like they're on a ventilator or like they're on a machine that's breathing for them. The more they do that, the less chance they have to get off of it, and they don't know how to go breathe, right? So the money's like the oxygen. And yet I hear this a lot, and I've been away from it so much that in the business world, I don't think about it, but I think some of the people out there maybe are when it comes to around building wealth, the shame around it, the desire for it. And one thing that we had talked about from who spoke at the Wellspring today?
Jamal.
Jamal had talked about the spirit of mammon. And I just want to know from your perspective, some of the ways you keep this like abundance mentality would probably be the best word for it in a way where it's positively impacting your business growth. He talked about, have you ever had anxiety about money? These are things of the spirit of mammon. Ever had anxiety about money? Have you ever made questionable decisions because of money? Have you ever let your P&L depict the mood of your household? Just crazy, right? Like good month, bad month, like all of that. Have you ever thought if I ever had more money, I could help more people and give to the kingdom? Have you ever thought that if I had more money, then people would listen to me and my problems would go away? Have you ever compared yourself to someone who has more financial success than you? And the spirit of mammon will lie and steal the joy out of building your business. For you, those are some big things that I think a lot of people have ever felt. I brushed through them really quickly. Yet for you, how do you keep that abundance mentality? A lot of people, I feel that they're like, oh God, I'm going to give you everything. The reason they don't give is because they're afraid they're going to lose something, right? They're not sitting there like, oh man, I'm going to give God my business and then he's going to 100-fold it, right? It's like, they're like, oh my goodness, I have control over this and I can make it good by myself. Like I can make some things happen. They don't know the multiplication that goes when you put it on his hands. How do you keep that abundance mentality where you're just like, man, I'm meant to win. I'm meant to go from glory to glory. I'm meant to prosper as my soul prospers.
Yep.
What's the secret?
One thing that I would say there, dude, is like, what do you want to be owned by? Because you are owned by money at that point. Like, it's what you want. It's what you're trying to hold on to. It's where you get your control. It's your high tower, right? I mean, that's who owns you right there. That's who owns you, right? So if you're like, man, I want, you know, like I can have this little thing and I can control it. And well, one, you can't. You could be dead tomorrow, right? You're not in charge. Right. You think it's your high tower. It says like, you know, rich person uses wealth as their high tower, but it could be gone tomorrow. Right. And so that's, you are currently a slave to that. And if you want to get out of that, you have to give, you have to build that muscle that separates you from that mentality. Wow. Because that can get you to the place where you realize, dude, I don't actually care about the money. I care about God's purpose. Right. Mm-hmm. And that's what God wants to see. He wants to see that pure heart. Right. He wants to see that. If he wants you to do something that has nothing to do with money, but he knows is the best plan for you and is his plan, which his plan is always the best for you, right? He's never got a plan that's bad for you, right? But it's whether or not you're willing to trust him when he tells you to do something. And a lot of people are like, oh my gosh, right? And God's gracious, dude. Like some people tell these, you know, I won't call them horror stories, but like sort of horror stories where God shows up and he's like, I want you to give it all, right? And so some business guys are like, I won't even give a little if that's what I'm walking towards. They're like, I don't want to ask God if he's going to, but I'll tell you this, God is gracious and he knows your limits, right? He knows where you're at. He's not a God that wants to punch you in the face. You know what I mean? And so he wants to grow you as a son or as a daughter, right? And so don't be like, that's a lie that Satan's telling you, that somehow God's going to do something scary. You know what I mean? Like, God's going to do something that you should fear. He won't. In fact, you should fear not asking God, right? Because if God wants you to give it all, it's not because God wants something worse for you. It's because he's got something so much better, right? So much better. And so if you start giving in little, right, you'll start to separate that so that you can put God first, and you're no longer owned. You're no longer a slave to money, right? And that's when God can, one, trust you with more and just astronomically bless you. But then two, that's also when you are living in the joy of the Lord, dude. That's when you're like, God is good. My life rocks. Amen. Praise the Lord, right? Like that's where that comes in, that freedom, that joy, that excitement, right? That comes in when you're no longer a slave to money. And so that's.
I like what you said about God knowing you. I had just talked to a lady and she was looking at, she was very reserved. She felt like she didn't like being uncomfortable. Mm-hmm. And I remember her saying something around like, well, it just seems like, you know, if you want to follow God, like he went to the disciples and said, drop everything and follow me. And like, it was always this like very uncomfortable thing where they had to like leave everything, go places you've never gone before, meet people, speak in front of people. And when we were talking, I was just like, just so you know, like whatever personality type you have, like you are made in the image of God. God is more of that personality type than you are. Mm-hmm. Like, yeah, he's all inclusive and we're all pieces of made in his image. Yeah, yep. I'm like, man, he understands it better than you do. And he understands you as a friend, right? This is like mm-hmm. the benefit, right? When I come from my demonic background, one of the craziest things is that like demons aren't omnipresent, right? So that's number one. Mm-hmm. It's like they can't be everywhere at the same time. So there's yep. strongholds or certain places that feel worse than others. But also like they don't know the future. I talked about this in another podcast. I go, I think they would have been like, don't kill that Jesus guy. Like, you know, let's keep tempting him a little bit more if they were to know, like,
yeah.
I already saw the future. Whereas, like, God's, like, in the future, in the past, in the present, outside of time yep. and space, yep. and is not affected by it, can visit, in, like, be anywhere, anytime, be 100% present with you and knows you as a friend, the intricacies, yep. the hairs on your head, like, the mm-hmm. like just knows you before you're even born. And I think yep. that's so big to remember when you're talking about. When I first came to Wellspring, actually, I got this vision for like growing spiritually and really converting what I'm doing now to King's Brotherhood.
Mm-hmm.
And, or converting what I was doing to King's Brotherhood. And I was really hating on myself. I was like, you did it wrong this whole time. You were following Jesus, but you weren't like showcasing that to everyone else. And so I just was really beating myself up. I was like, mm-hmm. have I not been growing? Like, I really wasn't reading the word that much. Like, I was still connected to God. Like I'd pray yep. and ask for help every day and like before I'd speak, but I wasn't like, again, knowing him as a friend, I knew him as a business partner. I was like, all right, God, let's go do this. Like use me because yeah, I'm out there. And yep. I was really feeling convicted about it. But when I asked God, God, is this actually like, what do you say? And he took me year by year from like 2012 every year and how he was like, look how faithful you were here. Look at where you talked about me here. Look at how you showed up here. And he showed me all these good things. Like, yep. like he's like, man, you did do it. You were doing it. You were doing the right thing. The path was correct. It just wasn't time yet. But because mm-hmm. I looked at what I was doing now, I'm like, man, what the heck was I doing in my life in the last like 7 years? You know, I was like, this feels weird. And, yep. but that wasn't his words. Those were mine. They were like self-judgment, yep. right? They were yep. me judging. And I thought, man, this is what God's going to say. It's like, yep. you know, you're sitting on your bed and your mom's like, just wait till your dad gets home. Sit there. And you're like thinking my dad's going to like yell at me or whatever. And the case yep. is sometimes that's correct, but oftentimes yep. we're wrong about yeah. simple situations. And I was wrong there. And so for everyone as well, like you said, man, like God knows you as a friend, and but he also believes in you. And if you don't believe yep. in you, he may push you past where you believe you can go because mm-hmm. you don't believe you can go there. But borrow his belief, right? It's like, I think that's good, so dude. Good, man. Like,
yeah, it's good. I think,
yeah, mm-hmm. go get it.
I was gonna say, dude, like God knows the desires of your heart, right? He also wants you to surrender those to him. So like he placed them there. You know what I mean? Like he placed those desires there, dude. He didn't place them there. So he's not going to fulfill on them. Like yep. God's not a goofball, bro. Like he placed the desires in your heart so that they would be fulfilled. Right. But he wants you to surrender them to him first. Right. Which means God, even if I know that this is the desire in my heart, but God, if you want me to go do this, I know you'd only give that to me because it was the best possible thing for me. And so I surrender this to you. This dream, this desire I have in my heart, well, I surrender to you and I want to do what you want me to do. And that's when God steps in and helps you fulfill those desires of your heart, right? So he knows you, right? He knows if you're super introverted and stuff, right? Or if you have a certain desire toward, you know, a proclivity to certain things, sometimes we get caught up in, like, you know, we're around a group of Christians and they're like about street evangelism. You know what I mean? Yeah, and that's just not you, but you feel like that's what actually being the quintessential Christian is now, because that's the group. And that's not what God said. That is not what God said, right? And so God knows what's in your heart. He placed those desires there. He wants you to surrender them to him, and then he wants to fulfill them.
I want to know your thoughts on this before we wrap up. The other day I was in worship, and my wife and I are trying to get pregnant. And there's quite a bit of a podcast story on that, but not the easiest path forward for my second kid. And it was interesting because I was praying for, like, we have this desire, right? I want another kid, but also want my business to succeed. I want to make a big impact. I want to have the number one podcast, should all have the biggest men's movement, whatever, like just all of it. And I was like, it clicked for me during worship that I was like, God, like, I want to submit my will to your will. And I was like, I want to raise up another kid that becomes someone that spreads your kingdom. Like, I will be entrusted to raise a kid to glorify you. And then I was like, well, why wouldn't he do that? Like, that's just like amazing. And then I got me thinking, this has been my theme for this week. I haven't even, I maybe told my guys yesterday. I go, wow, like, this is yesterday. My theme for this week is like, God, like, inside of my business, what's your will? Give me a glimpse of what it is, even if I'm already on it perfectly. But my frame now is, how can this interview, how can this call, how can this training, this program, this messaging further accomplish your will on the earth? And it gave me this new level of alignment, a new frame going, oh my goodness, I could be expecting for that. Now, my desire, sometimes it aligns, maybe sometimes it doesn't. I'm just like, God, give me the desires of your heart. And then you can give me the desires of my heart. I'm totally fine with that.
Yeah.
Because, you know, I would like to have that. And it's like, why wouldn't that happen? If he gives me a glimpse and I go, oh yeah, this, I want to raise a kid up for your kingdom. I want to raise a business up for your kingdom. The intention now shifts and my expectation also shifts as well. Now, I know you give us the desires of our heart. So I don't want to get to that point where it's like your desires don't matter.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You only can have desire if it's from him. So it's already a gift. Yet the frame was different. How do you frame it for you? Or what do you think about that?
So you said a lot of beautiful things there, but I kind of missed what the heart of the question was. How do I frame?
So there's a lot of people right now that may be like wanting to build a business.
Yep.
But they just don't know what's the real will of God for their life, or how do they align it with the will of God, or how do they feel that this is building something bigger than themselves? I mean, think about it, even for me. I have this Christian businessman's mastermind. You know how many people want to – and Pete has the Wellspring Christian mastermind. It's convicted people. They're like, what am I doing, bro? Like, am I supposed to do that? You talked about even the evangelism. You get a lot of this, like, thing. But also I feel like sometimes we can get caught up in doing the will of God and not actually being a part of it. Like, think about how God orchestrates Pharaoh and Joseph. And, like, there's times where God's appointed someone who is not godly, and they don't know that they're carrying out the will of God, so they can't enter into the joy. But how many business owners are out there, they're carrying out the will of God, but they don't even know it? How do we align ourselves with that so we can, like, see that we're carrying out the work of God?
That's super good, dude. That's a great question, man. And one thing that I would say,
I don't know. Who freaking knows?
Yeah, I don't know, right? That's awesome.
I thought about this yesterday, so I'm like, I'm still trying to figure it out.
It's good, dude. I love it. Well, one thing I would say, dude, is if someone's out there and they're like, man, I want to start a business, but I want to know if it's God's will, just start it. Like, God placed the desire in your heart. Businesses are good. Tithe, give on it, right? Align it around God's will and go to town. Right? Like, you don't want to start a business. Not everyone wants to start a business. That's one thing. Everyone thinks that everyone else is like them. Wrong. Right? There are tons of people that do not have any desire whatsoever to start a business. God's placed a desire in you to start a business. Get going. Right? Let's go. Quit messing around.
It's like we choose our path and God directs our steps. Like,
exactly. Yes, exactly, dude. Beautiful. Exactly. Really, and so, really, yeah, like, you've got the desire. It's going to be good. You're going to use it for God's glory. Let's go. It's like, God placed the desire. Quit monkeying around, being like, should I actually do this? Should I not do this? If you're listening to this podcast, the answer is yeah. The answer is yes. You know what I mean? Like, you're listening to a God and business podcast, not God and fitness, right? It's not God and, I don't know, what's some other cool thing? Neurosurgery, right? So, like, you probably don't have a desire to do neurosurgery.
Not God in unemployment either.
Yeah, it's not even that. Yeah, seriously. But that's my thought, dude. Is like, if you have got the desire to start a business, businesses are good. Go to town, right? Like, don't go like, and if it glorifies God, it's all good. I mean, like, go to town. So you're supposed to do it,
dude. Any way that people can connect to you, what you're doing, any final thoughts, it's yours, and we'll wrap it up.
Oh, dude, just that this was a blast, man. So I appreciate you putting in the effort and the hard work to make this thing a reality. And yeah, dude, maybe just a prayer. If I can end in a prayer for everyone listening, that'd be awesome.
Bro, I've totally forgot. This is my theme too. Like, I haven't done one where we haven't had the guest release what they talked about in their breakthrough over the audience. So thank you.
Done.
All right, I had the path, but then God used you to direct my step back.
Whatever.
It's because I got a text and my wife got pulled over by a cop because I didn't have a license plate on my truck. So I was like,
oh, okay. No.
I'm like, okay.
All right, we'll wrap quick.
Please, yes.
Cool. Father God, I love you, Lord. Jesus, we just love you. We thank you so much that we get to be sons and daughters. I just ask that you bless everyone listening to this. You know that they've got desires on their heart, Father God. They want to start businesses. Some of them want to start like a tailor business or a car wash, Father God. Other ones want to be in research and development, some consulting for companies, Father God. I just want to bless them all. I want to send them off right now, Lord, that they can do your work, Father God, that they would go after culture in the mountain of business for you, Father God, that souls would be saved, Father. Souls would be saved. People would be healed. People would hear the gospel preached through their work, Father God, through their businesses. Thank you for anointing them, Lord, and just placing that mantle of being a professional in business, Father God, over them. Thank you for blessing their families. Thank you for giving them vision for the future, giving them operational and tactical skill, Father God, and strategy to succeed in today's marketplace. We love you so much. Thank you for everything. Thank you for your heart for us, placing your dreams in our hearts. We love you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Cool.
Amen.
Awesome, bro.